can tell we're all sort of rusty at this. Should I clap? Should I stand? It's been so long since all of us on stage and all of you in the audience have shared a concert experience together. And so I am so honored to be here. My name is Donato Cabrera. I'm the guest conductor, and I would like to thank the fantastic students of the San Francisco Conservatory Music Orchestra and their music director, Edwin Outwater, for inviting me. These last 2 weeks have been such a joy, and it is really such a momentous occasion that we're all here tonight after being apart from one another for so long. So relish each and every minute. The first piece on the program is a piece by the British Caribbean composer who resides in New York City, Hannah Kendall. It's a piece called Verdala. And Verdala was a boat that the West Indies Regiment took to fight a war on the other side of the world, World War I. And in many ways, this captures that sense of unknowing, not being sure what's ahead, and of course, the terror that one faces when you're put into combat. Hannah Kendall's Verdala.
Thank you.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. The next two pieces you're about to hear are music that now is over 100 years ago. They were composed by the great but young Igor Stravinsky. In the rehearsal process, I was always trying to encourage all of us to think about the hustle and bustle of early 20th century Paris, where there were still carriages fighting for the space on the street with the newfangled automobiles and the car horns and the hustle and bustle of a new economy. Stravinsky originally wrote these pieces for his two children. They were piano pieces, and he later orchestrated them. One of the hallmarks of these wonderful small pieces, these suites for small orchestra, is that while the forces on stage are small and very compact, his choice of instruments, when and how, is a mark of a master. It sounds always like a fantastically large orchestra somehow. So here we have Stravinsky's suites number 1 and 2. There'll be a little break in between, so feel free to clap. By Igor Stravinsky.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Before we begin, a piece that hardly needs an introduction. For those of you watching online, perhaps for the first time, you've noticed one thing that is quite obvious to all of us, but has been solved in a wonderful way. Our breathers, those of us that breathe in order to, what we should all breathe when we play our instrument, right, strings? Those of us who are woodwind and brass players, they are not on stage with us. They are scattered throughout the conservatory in various classrooms, and we are employing an incredible technology, the Dante sound system, which somehow, and I just rather just assume it's magic, let's just say it's magic. When I give a downbeat, they are exactly with me and with us on stage. I really don't know how it happens. For the last 2 weeks of rehearsal, I've been constantly amazed by the technology, but a technology aside, what is incredible are these fantastic artists sitting in these rooms by themselves, these woodwinds and brass players making such glorious music with one another. That is the magic, and we should applaud them for their incredible efforts. Thank you, woodwinds and brass. I'm not, you guys are great too. Don't be worried. Beethoven's Seventh Symphony, as I said, barely needs an introduction. It's just, I would like for those of you who are hearing it perhaps for the first time, traditions have changed incredibly since this was premiered. And one of the traditions that I have tried to get rid of is the idea of that you cannot clap between, one mustn't clap between movements. At the premiere of the Seventh Symphony, the second movement was an immediate hit, so much so that they played the second movement again before going on to the third and fourth movement. Why? They clapped. They showed their appreciation. I know all of you are too well-schooled to clap, perhaps, between the movements, but if you find yourself wanting to, please do it. It's the way it should be. Okay, here's Beethoven 7.
Thank you. Thank you. There we go. If I could just ask you all to sit for just a couple of minutes, we're gonna get everybody on stage here so we can get an applause for even those folks that had to be isolated in the room, all of our Luke players. And so as we wait for them, there's a couple of people I wanna thank for, boy, it's been a long year, it's been a challenging year, and as I look out and see students and faculty here, it's nice that we got through it all together. It has not been easy to put something like this together. We have, a dozen or more rooms that are linked into here. We have students on stage listening behind them. And that takes more than a village, it takes a conservatory to get done. And there are a few people I want to thank. At the back of the house there, I want to thank Hank Mao and his incredible team, John DeRosa. Yeah. Hank's team is Chris Ramos and John Jaworski. It's a new addition, Amory Daniels, who is with us tonight. It's the incredible recording services team, which is Jason O'Connell and Kelly Coyne. All the student workers that help along with that. Not an easy thing to manage an orchestra on stage and in another dozen or more rooms. So I have to say, Brian Lynn and Sydney Apple, amazing work. We started the year here with about 12 people we could put on stage, and today we had 20. I think that's kind of amazing. We got 60 people here in the audience tonight. This is the first time we've had this many people in this hall in 14 or 15 months. It's great to see you all. Let's see here. I think I hear them rolling in, right? Okay, so I don't have to tell any jokes.
No jokes. So let's go.
Okay, let's do it. Hey, let's get the wood players out.